difficult to go through the paper. vocabulary is different, the concepts are different, and everything seems strange. So I think we are lucky now to have with us Professor Dr. Mustafa Amr Sayyid with us, to just give us a clue and open the door for this group of sciences that probably will be the sciences in the next 2 or 3 decades. I think we are a sleeping agent. مش واخدين بالنا، مزاجنا وحش، ما بنشتغلش، مش متفرغين. كليات العلوم والهندسة والعلوم الأساسية في الغيبوبة التامة ينسحب علينا قوم حافظ إبراهيم سنة 1907 بعد أن هزم اليمنيون روسيا القيصرية في معركة برية واحتلت منشوريا ثم معركة البحر. فقال: هل في مصر بحيرة سوى الألقاب والرتب؟ أروني نصف مخترع، أروني ربع محتسب. ماذا في مدارسكم؟ ماش جامعة، مش في مدارس. من التعليم والكتب، ماذا في صحائفكم سوى التمويه والكذب؟ فهبوا من مراكبكم فإن الوقت من ذلك. لعل زيارة الدكتور مصطفى السيد لجعلنا نجاة من مراكبنا. Professor Mustafa Sayyid, the Julius Brown Chair and Regent Professor, the Director of the Laser Dynamic Laboratory in the Georgia Tech, Institute of Technology in Georgia. He obtained his BSc Science Bachelor degree in Ancient University, then his PhD in Florida State University. Thereafter, he had a journey in the United States, probably went to the best prestigious, he worked in the most prestigious universities. Yale, Harvard, University of California. And then, as he said, he settled in Georgia because he was offered an offer that he cannot refuse. He used the magic expression. I gave him an offer that he cannot refuse. Possibly lots of money for research, space for his laboratories, instrumentation, budget for recruit students and researchers. Throughout his academic career, he obtained many, many academic awards. I think that the most important is that this is the American Chemical Society National Award in Chemical Physics. Very important, Dr. National. King Faisal Award for Science and Chemistry. And he's a member of the U.S. National Academy of Science. We are proud to have him with us, and I hope we can now understand what all about nanotechnology, and probably we have some enthusiasm and energy and adrenaline to pour in our circulation in order to work and do better than what we have now. Thank you very much.
مع اليابان طبعا ومع اوروبا عندنا كان في نشاط منهم قول تكنولوجي وزير البحث
وزير الوزير بتاع البحث العلمي يعني له كلمة وبعد وقت يعني من تريننج فيلوشيبس I have already two Egyptians I know four they're waiting to get the fellowship and they will be getting it sent a letter of invitation so the number is increasing so في مجهود يعني في hope إن في حاجة لأن في هذا المجال زي ما أقول to make nanoparticles is really we are very good at this Egyptians are very good at making things so everybody is making I had a student that she got her PhD with me Muna Muhammad and she my American student used to go and ask her how did you do this they all used to tell her she has a green thumb she makes particles nobody else could make it so we have this, the ability and I'm sure الحكومة will support إن شاء الله في المركزة والمركزة اللي تشتغل والمعاونة معاه كلنا نتعاون مع بعض في هذا المجال وبال catch up and we'll be even ahead in this field and it's a beginning it's not like we are already too late it's a beginning we can start from the beginning with a good chance and it will have very good opportunity إن شاء الله okay well now let's get to it what is it Well, so I will first give you some properties and how you make them, and then we'll go into the optical properties. We'll concentrate mostly on gold because it turned out actually the gold for some reason is one of the most useful nanoparticles so far that can be used for medicine, for example, and for other. Many other things when it is cut to the nanometer scale. Okay. Then we will refer to Feynman property of gold and show that the optical property of gold is wonderful in diagnosing cancer cells. Very easy, simply microscope, and you can tell whether a cell is cancer or not. And once it is sitting on the top of the cancer cell, with weak light, it doesn't get any, very weak laser, which came to second about a laser like that, very weak CW laser, one of the weakest lasers we can get. You shine light a little bit on it for a few minutes, it kills all the cancer cells and leaves the healthy one untouched. So very selective, and we'll show you how it's done. And we'll show you some animal experiments on that. Now, how small is a nanometer? How small is one nanometer? It is on a scale lead, the hairs are on a scale lead that in the مثلاً قلتوانا يبقى one nanometer على نفس الscale الكرة الأرضية كلها تبقى 30 سنتيمتر. Nanometer is very small, very small. If you want to feel it, امسك شعر واحد وحسب what the width is. One hair that is 50,000 nanometers. 50,000 nanometers. So that gives you. So the nanometer material is somewhere between molecules and the bigger thing, microelectronics and microelectronics, is somewhere in between. And for some reason, it was left untouched before, but now because of the fact that it has so many good properties, it is higher than the layer had mentioned. It is higher. لما تغير شكلها بتديك يعني خواص مختلفة جديدة أوي بأي ماتيريال بحيث يعني يمكن some of it ممكن يستخدمها في الصناعة وعندنا وظائف ونبيع حاجات للناس it opens up the country's economy and that's what every country is very excited about and the width of a human hair is 50,000 nanometers Nanoscience, there are two words, buzzwords you hear probably these days.
nano science and nanotechnology. Well, we all know that you have to understand science first to make use of the results of the science, some of it, to make new technology to sell and make use of in medicine, in our home, in a car, or whatever. So the nanoscience is the field of synthesis, and that's a lot of this now, to make nanoparticles and the study of the properties of material having size between 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer. Greater than 100, you get in the micro range, you get into microelectronics, you get into micro chips, and so on and so forth. Below 100, you are in this regime that things can change and you see new properties altogether. What do new properties mean? Well, let us take an example. Let's take the chocolate that I came to pick in my infection. Contaminated my computer. حتى الشوكولاتة مثلا 1 جرام. قطعها 1000 حتة. If you eat it, it will fill you up the same way as if you have eaten 1 gram all of it together. No difference. Then you start, now you want to get in the nanotechnology area. So what you do, you cut this 1 gram into 10 pilots. 10 billion piles. Each pile has a lot of small pieces of chocolate, has a billion small pieces of chocolate. So, billion of piles, qualified, 1 billion small pieces of chocolate. Each one of them will be in the nanometer scale. Then you take all these piles, you still have 1 gram in your hand, and then you eat it. It might be bitter, it might not have a taste. It might make us feel good, it might make us feel sick. And that's what we mean, it changes the property. It's not just that the database is small, because it is small, the size is scaling. It is not the size of scaling, you still have 1 gram. But the property is completely different. Now, but why? Why when you get to the nanometer scale, the properties don't change? Well, it's a very simple thing. We are all scientists, we have to touch with science, we know how the atoms move. And it turned out that the property of any material, whether a piece of wood or a piece of copper, is determined by the size or the length in which the electron can move freely. A conductor, you have to move from distance 50, 70 nanometers. At the insulator, the electrons are stuck between two atoms, covalent bond. It doesn't go anywhere. So if I have a regular, long, saturated organic compound, and I put electrons on both sides, you know that the conductivity. Because each two electrons is stuck between two atoms, so cannot go move. And that's why you have insulator. So the property of the material depends how far the electron can move in this material. But it turned out that the length scale for different materials is between 1 nanometer to 100 nanometer for different materials. So if I take a piece, let's take a piece of copper that the electron can move 35, 38 nanometer before it gets knocked out with one of the ions in the lattice. Suppose now we cut this below 35 nanometer, the electron will not move that much of a distance anymore. So the property, the conductivity, everything will change. Everything will change. So you can see, once we're in this range, we're interfering in the motion of the electron. It doesn't move the same distance as it was before. Therefore, you get a new material, because the electron now can only move a smaller distance. And if you change its shape, or if you cut it even smaller, it changes, if the property changes even more. So the idea that any material can give us so many different kinds of materials of the same substance, and some of it might have some interesting property that I can build a new industry on it, or make a new medicine out of it, or whatever. This idea says, well, the door is open for a lot of industries in a company, in a country, to be able to be made. So as you can see here in this little shape that we have here, you can see here the property of the material as I decrease the size is constant, until I get the 100 nanometer scale. Then the property starts really changing and changes. The more I cut it even smaller, the more change I get in it. And some of these properties somewhere here might be quite useful. Okay. Now, well, the height is very obvious. I already told you why the height is just this thing here. The properties of material are determined by the space available for their electrons to exude their characteristic motion. This space is usually measured in nanometer length scale. By changing the material size or shape around this space will change its properties and make it sensitive to size and shape. Thus, on the nanometer scale, every material can give me many, many, many new materials with different properties. Some will improve our lives or our health, thus can start in new industries and thus new jobs and thus the whole economy can be affected. Now, different material change its property in different ways as you get to that nanometer scale. For example, the semiconductor. Semiconductors has the property that you move an electron from where it lives. It leaves it behind a positive charge. You separate an electron from its positive charge. And that distance is in the nanometer scale. So if I cut the size below that, I'm letting the electron cannot move that far. I'm confining the box in which the electron moves. And as you recall, undergrad classes, the particle in a box. If I have an electron in a box and then increase the size of the box, the energy level splits, moves from one another to bigger space. That means the color, which goes up from the absorption of this electron, from taking it from where it is to a higher energy level, changes. So I can keep changing the color of a semiconductor by just changing its size. I can get any color I want, depending on what I want to use it for. All of it from the same chemical, like cadmium sulfide or cadmium selenide or whatever the material is. Transition methods. Well, you all know that gallium, for example, is very useful. Industry, catalysis, it makes things faster. Every industry can think of, they always looking for a catalyst to make what they are making faster, so they can sell more tons per day than usual and get more money during the year. Now, if I take a gram of a piece of platinum, the catalysis always occurs on the surface of that piece. Only the atoms on the surface, they see the reaction around them, and they can help the reaction. The ones inside, they never see what's the reaction. So the number of atoms on the surface are the most important in catalysis. Now when a piece of metal, one atom in 10 million sit on the surface. If I cut this into nanometer particles, 85% of the atoms are sitting in the surface. You can see you are using most of the atoms for catalysis. So you should expect much more catalysis if you cut down the size of the particles of this material in the nanometer scale. So that's a whole field, a lot of work going on in catalysis with nanoparticles right now. Metals, gold, silver, and that's what we're talking about today. The gold is very precious because it doesn't do anything. It does not react. It keeps its shine. As we see in part, a wonderful thing they made for him. It's still the same shine as the day they put it together 2,300 years ago. So it's precious because it doesn't do anything. Now, gold makes up for it. When you cut it to the nanoscience, it does many, many things. So it's precious because it does many, many things. And we show some of it as we go along. How do we make these nanoparticles? Well, there are two ways. To make small pieces, the hardest way is to take a big piece and try to cut it into smaller pieces. We don't have the machines when you get to the nano. Microscope to cut things in that small. We can do it by very expensive machines like electron diffraction, electron beams, and things like this, and it doesn't give it too small, it can be too big. But the easiest way for us, and that's what's going on now everywhere, we start from the bottom up. We start from the atoms, and atoms, and build them up, add them together, and build the size of the one, and then we stop it. Carry is a polymer or some organic substance or inorganic substance. This was called the bottom up, starting small and the build up. For example, if I want to make gold, nanoparticle, I start with gold salt, gold chloride, and have gold ions. And then I reduce the metal ions into atoms. I put in reducing agent, citric acid, aspartic acid, hydrogen in the solution. So now the ions become atoms. The atoms get together, they like to cluster together. But you don't want it to cluster too much, otherwise they all get together and make a piece of metal and fall out from the water. You don't want to do that. So you always have there what we call a carrying material. That's what I said, organic. Polymer that is hydrophilic, that has polar groups that can stay in water. And this caps, depends on its concentration, these clusters at a certain size. And you can adjust the size by adding more or less of this carrying material. And we end up with a certain, not only certain size, sometimes under certain conditions, different shapes. That's a very easy thing, and my goodness, Egyptians have no problem already making a lot of very exciting parts in the laser center there in Cairo University. If you say conductor, precipitate freshman chemistry part of it. See, I never prepared an organic point in my life. It's very difficult for me to make an organic point, to make a substitution, a condensation, all these fancy names that wonderful organic chemists they do all the time. But to make them apart is much easier, much easier. In semiconductor, you start with two, for example, if you want to make cadmium silicide, you start with soluble salt of calcium ions and soluble salt of silicide ions of some kind. And you mix them together, the cadmium and the silicide get together and they stick together and they remember that their solubility product is very, very low. They're not supposed to be dissolving. So before they get together and gang together and try to fall down, you have a carrying material to keep them in solution and with a certain size. So the carrying material here, right here, has these two functions. The carrying material, it does control size or shape, as well as the carrying material itself dissolves in water, for example, so it keeps them dissolved in water. That's a very easy technique. Now the top-down, which is the physicist and the engineer type, they use electron beam or photolithography, and the electron beam just essentially it can make a hole of a certain size in a piece of polymer, for example, and then you deposit, for example, gold atoms in these holes, and then you dissolve away the polymer. You end up with something, these little gold particles sitting at certain distance you fix. So this technique is wonderful if you want to make devices, to make them as close as you want and near one another or far away from one another and research machine. The easier, but we don't make very small ones from that, is mirroring, but that's a very big, bigger pieces, and spin coating, make them and spread them to make a assembly of them. So these are techniques that the material engineers they do and they're very good at. Now, let us some uses in medicine. Well, this is just really a simple thing. In fact, I'm working them all together. Simple healing. Drug delivery, you can know more about this. You don't need this really. You know more about this than normal. This is for the general non-medical person. How you deliver medicine somewhere. You use a system to carry them. Well, it must ensure that they are released when they are there. The system itself does not provide any healing effect. It just carries the drug itself by taking chemotherapy, carrying itself. Same as in a polymer that dissolves after a while, and when they release the drug or whatever it is. These are sort of conventional drug delivery systems, such as pills or injections, really. Rely largely on the body of the transport of the drug and then put it in the blood flow and it takes it where it is and then accumulate it in a certain place. Using nanoparticles will improve on this. In fact, the whole thing, you can buy gold nanoparticles, you can put on it, certain drugs on it, and you inject with IV and it goes to accumulate cancer cells or whatever it is. Okay, in drug liver, that is what we have. Smart drugs, these are the nanomaterial which becomes active inside the cell only when an infection invaded. There's an infection there. So there's some signal to whatever is on the nanoparticle that releases when there's an infection. And it takes a benefit from microchip based devices that dumps nanoliters of drugs from reservoirs. By receiving nanoparticles, is of the same size as many biological systems. DNA is a nano size. Protein must be protein. RNA nanometer scale. So they are together essentially the same type of system. That is what excites people in biology and nano, and people in the nano trying to learn biology to see what kind of combine the two together. Very hot field. Nanobiology is a big field right now. So nature knows about nano for a long, long time from the beginning. We're just finding out about it, I think. The bioelicin molecule attaches to the cell membrane and it secretes the drugs inside from where it is transported within the cell itself. Hydrogels are very interesting, have a property that when it feels a temperature, for example, our body temperature is higher than room temperature. So you put it in a certain thing and it gets in the body, reach a certain temperature, all of a sudden it opens up. Whatever is there just comes out. So using temperature to deliver the drugs. Magnetic, this is very, very important. And they already have some experiments on this actually. They found out, for example, that magnetic nanoparticles, if they deliver somewhere where you look at MRI, many times before MRI can detect a disease, this is enhanced sensitivity enough that way before MRI can see it, sees it. So it's wonderful for early screening, for example. So using enhancements, X-ray, now they come with all nanoparticles. If you put it in there, you can irradiate a certain area with cancer at much lower doses, but the gold has so many electrons in it that when you shine X-ray on it, it shoots all so much electrons from that region where you want to destroy that you don't have to raise the dose of the X-ray very high. So there are a lot of these combination of properties and cure that has been used and developed right now. Not quite used as much yet, but it's been developed in animals and all sorts of things. Imaging, can I see things? Well, I already said the MRI. The importance of medical imaging, of course, increased in the last century, beginning of this century. Innovation, radiation, imaging technology, magnetic resonance imaging, fluoroscopy, computer tomography, ultrasound have greatly enhanced the physician's ability to detect problems early enough and provide for effective treatment. They provide patients with a minimal, minimal invasive criteria to help diagnosis impairment problems such as bone fracture, as well as ulcer and tumors and so on. Recent advances in nanotechnology and imaging, and we'll show some of this, have allowed researchers to take imaging to the next level up. This includes reliable tracking of molecular and cellular movement within a person, 3D imaging, and early detection of cancers, and that's what we will be working on. Well, there is quantum dots. There are two things that have been used in imaging, effectively nanotechnological system. One of them is the semiconductor nanopart. And they usually call it quantum dot. You get what quantum dot, it is a nano semiconductor nanopart. It has fantastic fluorescence emission. It has very strong absorption. Fluorescence emission, that means it can be used in place of dyes. Actually, it is better than dyes, much sharper, and it gives you pure colors. And as I said, you can change the color you want by changing the size of the semiconductor. So you can select many colors or one color. So it gives you a much easier way of fixing and how does it do it? It doesn't do it by fluorescence, by brightness. Imaging, you always shine light and you see light coming out in the microscope. Bodies usually use fluorescence, but the golden part scatters light so strongly, so you see these little mirrors, nano mirrors, much stronger than the reflection. The scatter is having all the light that gets coming. So you see this bright light coming at you. If you put some light on your sample, you see this light coming at you very strongly, and that is not fluorescence, it's just the light. Not only the light, it's not the light you put it in either. It is the light at which the nanoparticle likes to scatter light more effectively. So its characteristic of the nanoparticle itself. The light that gets scattered is correct. I can put in white light. If I put in gold nanoparticle, the light that comes at me, and we'll show you this in a minute, is actually greenish, strong greenish color. If the nanoparticle is around, you see red colors coming at me. So it depends on the shape as well. So these properties are wonderful, and it get destroyed. Like fluorescent dyes get to react with oxygen and so on. Gold nanoparticle will sit there, it doesn't phototherapy or photochemically change the style. Bone and blood, that's it, can be used for imaging cancer, monitoring blood flow, mapping blood vessels, and they allow for 3D imaging. Beautiful work in blood and living area. And possible concern, of course, in this whole nano area is what are the toxicities? Like any other thing, if you are using it inside your body, what is going to do to the body. And my goal, of course, is one of the most useful. It turned out that quantum dots, semiconductor, are definitely more toxic. And then gold nanoparticle is not bad. It's actually gold metal is being used more all of the time. Also you can use it for enhancement of certain measurements over the last 15 years, actually. But still, we don't know what the long term effects. So many of these little things in there. So that a lot of work in the next 5 years will be, in fact, we already have a big plan to study toxicity of different nanoparticles. Detection, there are also many applications of nanotechnology in disease detection. The field of nanomedicine has advanced new methods for detecting the presence of cancer, as well as viruses or mutated genes. Genes change shape or disappear. You can always find out what happens to them. With nanosensors, these problems can be fixed already. Different researchers have developed preliminary sensors for detecting the presence of cancer cells, viruses, and genes. The potential for such technology has gone down. There's a lot of work to be done still in the early stage right now. In the future, we may be able to instantly diagnose the patient with a simple handheld device. In fact, my son is a surgeon. His EMT surgery. And we already think that it's very easy to be able, while he's cutting something in the throat there, find out where the end boundaries of the cancer is. By just spraying some of these bone marrow particles, his antibodies, and stay for 10 minutes or so, using some white light, as I said, he you get this cover in the right hand and all information about the cancer case. And then, as I'll show you in a minute, you can add this into a laser, a weak laser, where the nanoparticles are, they absorb that light and heat up the cancer cells and kill them. So it's like a two-hand thing. Might even be same, the thing you'll be getting there to find out that there is a white light, and looking at the green light coming at them back, and then switch it, become a laser light coming at them, and it just goes around, killing the cancer cells where the gold is going to be sitting. So, wonderful, it's a fine surgery. I want to be doing it in time. You don't like to do the cut and then send it to the lab to see where the cancer is. You are seeing it. It's going to be wonderful. Nanoparticle detection, well, gene detection, as we said about that. Also, cancer detection, we said about this, and we'll work more about this now. Okay. Here is a good example of the semiconductor nanoparticles. All these colors here are all of them chemical signal. They're all the same material. And they all cut in the nanometer scale. The difference is each particle here is 2.3 nanometer, while each particle here is about 5.5 nanometer. So between this size and this size, you can get all the colors invisible. Okay. And this is now, as I said, it's a nice beautiful scatter. Very beautiful. And calcium cyanide, that's actually fluorescent, sorry. Calcium cyanide, this is fluorescent. The gold gets scattered. Now, when the absorption itself, also look at the change in the absorption spectrum for different sizes. And the color of the nanoparticle itself is changing. Not just the fluorescent, but the color of each one of them. So you can use either absorption spectrometer or fluorometer. And whatever detection you are trying to detect. Now here's a very nice experiment that shows you how you can diagnose it, can see if you have cancer cells or not. If you take, in this case, Alvisarsa-Berti, what he did, he took three chemicals, three semiconductors, different semiconductors, and in each one, of course, when you make a sample, you cannot make all of them the same size. All of them have that dispersion in sizes. That means dispersion in colors. In the same sample preparation. So for one sample, you get all these dispersion colors you have there. Another chemical, you get this color here. And the third chemical, you get this dispersion color. You mix all of these together. Okay. Now you can cover, in terms of color, all the way from this region to this region. Huge. Visible near infrared light image. Then you take the solution and you get a tissue or something and you shape incubate this tissue with them, say an hour, half an hour or so, take out water excess, put it under the microscope and be excited. Here's what he saw. You see here, he sees green ones. Now remember the green ones here, but the outside of the cell, he sees the red ones. Red ones means larger size nanoparticles. Green one, smaller size than the part. So it depends on the size in the cell, characteristic size of binding of these different, this nanoparticle, it tells you that you have bigger size here than here. But more important than this is a healthy cell. If he takes a cancer cell, this is not going to be the image. You might get more bigger one inside the cell itself. It's more porous, it's more not as tied together. So you can, in a one shaping and looking under the microscope, you can tell which one is a cancer cell and which one is a healthy cell. It's a beautiful thing for just diagnostics. Okay, now let's get to gold. Okay, the entitlement which I was about to say, metallic gold is more precious on the nanoscale. If you can't have a grain or whatever, thing you have in gold into many, many, many piles of billions and billions and billions of particles of gold, you get a much more precious application for it. But don't do it, no one's going to do it anyway, take that thing. I'm crazy to do that, I've got a beautiful piece of gold ornament I can do, I cannot do that. is an individual, but gold is beautiful. And it's been like this forever. It's about 2300 years, no, 3300 years, it's been looking like this. Because it does not react with oxygen, it does not react with water, it's very, very inert in chemical behavior. Okay. Now, if you go to the nanoscale, it makes me as many things. Gold nanoparticles really can be very strongly and get a lot of reaction. So for the professor that teach freshman chemistry, when you say gold is an inert element, that is a wrong statement. I have to specify what science. In nanoscale, it is not inert at all. It's very, very active. Okay. Some optical properties of gold nanoparticles. Here is a very interesting thing. The Romans had this thing, they had a magic thing there. This is a Roman cup, they call it, about 400 AD. And you see this rose color, and then you see the green color coming. If you have a white part, and if you put the white part inside the cup, coming through the midlater of nanoparticles, gold nanoparticles, it absorbs the green color. Then the rose color that you see is really the complementary color of the green color. All the remaining colors instead of green, all of it together is rose. So that's when you see that rose color. So this is as a result of strong absorption of the gold nanoparticles. The green here, if I put it outside, the light scattered. Light and scatter strongly the green color, even though it's white, I can put it on it, but I see green, because that is what this nanoparticle will scatter most, the green color. If it is a rod, it will be near infrared, the red color scattered to me, so. Okay, well, we all know that this famous, all the materials all over Europe, these stained glasses here, they were made in the 1700, and they all are gold nanoparticles. They just never knew it was a nanoparticle because they didn't have a transmission back to microscope to see how big the particle is. Well, it was later, in 1870 or so, after Maxwell's equation came, that Mr. Mie gave us the Mie equation and he explained about this beautiful, brilliant, strong absorption and strong scattering of gold nanoparticles come from. He said, if I take a gold, say a gold sphere here, and it is in the nanometer scale, and I pass light through it, what happened is the wave of the light, the electric field of the light, starts polarizing so many electrons in the conduction band in the gold, up and down to the surface and back, surface and back. As a result, you can see here, at one instant, a positive charge, because when the electron goes this side, it leaves behind positive charges, and then the field changes, then positive electrons here, positive charges here. So you find that you have an oscillating electric field on the surface of the particle. In other words, if I have a nano finger, that I can feel the fields, and I put it close to that surface, I feel the field is changing, oscillating up and down, like an electric current. I could have put my hand in a socket or something. So, and this strong field does a lot of things, and many, many different properties, as we will be sure. So, what we call the surface plasma oscillation, you see SP, or SP, or what I have in the SPR, surface plasma resonance. When the light hits the gold nanoparticle or silver, it gives you this oscillation of the electrons up and down, creating this field. So it's a covalent oscillation of the collective excitation of free electrons in the metal by absorbing resonant radiation and leading to strong surface fields. We don't have this in many other systems. Semiconductor doesn't have this very strong field created anyway. Let me just show you how much absorption and scattering cares.
You know, all the colors that you see around, these are because the absorption of one electron in the material. Now, here we talk about billions and billions of electrons being absorbed. That's why it's very strong. So, it's absorbed almost a million times stronger than any diamond. It scatters light almost a million times stronger. How much can I adjust the scattering and the absorption? Yes, you can. One of my students did that, and he showed that if you use 20 nanometer nanoparticle, most of the disappearance of light will be due to absorption. If you go to 60 nanometer, you find the scattering becomes important, and then the absorption. If you go to 100 nanometer, all the light is going to be scattered back. It's very important what application you want it for. If you want imaging, you want something that's scattered light too much to you, so you can see it in microscope. If you want absorption that will eat whatever is around it, like getting rid of cancer cells, it takes smaller than one. So it's very important by adjusting the size to adjust the property itself.
The other opportunity in the color, but basically, just tell you how can I change how can I change the color of an animal? What is it, size, shape? And by changing the light vector constant to the material. For example, if something gets absorbed on the surface of the animal, and those electrons go up to the surface, they see what is there. If there's something that lights electrons, so they slow down a little bit, they get some love and affection, so they don't go back fast. So the frequency of oscillation slows down. If they see something they don't like, oscillation gets up. So again, oscillation means color. But the wavelength of the light that's created that oscillation will change. And this has been used greatly as sensors. If it absorbs a gas molecule that's very poisonous, the color becomes a different one than before that molecule sits in the cells. So in sensor, that's why a lot of application in sensor, different gases, different liquids, different this and different that, alcohol in the breath, to see if somebody's drunk or not, extremely sensitive to measure that. By just looking and seeing what the color of the nanoparticle change, how much, how strong, and that would tell them how much alcohol is there in the breath. By changing the shape of the nanoparticle, we'll use this today because if you go from a sphere to an arm, a nanoarm, you can move more and more into the near infrared, which you want to do. You want to do something inside the body. You want to go to wavelength which is the body's transparent to. And if you want the nanoparticle absorb that light, you have to change its shape, so its absorption will also change. By changing the composition of the nanoparticle, some units also have been used for diagnostics and therapy of cancer by Halas of Price. And this is just by taking a silicon sphere and just putting a shell around it, and by adjusting the thickness of the shell, you can move that anywhere you want. Thicker one goes to high energy, high frequency. Thinner one, it goes into the infrared. And this is again used in diagnostics and therapy of cancer, using medical applications and photonics. By changing the distance between nanoparticles, we have shown, and I showed the results first, that if two nanoparticles get close to one another and they feel their fields, this oscillating fields, the color shifts along the way. And from that shift, you can tell how close these two nanoparticles are. Now this is going to be, this is just new, just paper to scale out, keep up the road. It can be used in diagnostics too. I mean, if I have a DNA that's defective and I know nanoparticles will divide and bind into two nuclear ions, for example, I know the distance between them is, and if I determine by the color long distance is supposed to be that the DNA is defect. So in biology, it's like a ruler, a distance ruler. Okay. Using biology, DNA sequencing, and so on and so forth. Now this is just, I've just shown the results. If I had a name of art, there are two oscillations. One oscillation when the electron go this way along the long axis, the other oscillation when they go along the short axis. This is the effect of the Vihannes as here's a sphere of silica, and then I put gold the shell around. If it is thick, I absorb here. If it is thin, I absorb here. So we can adjust about the thickness of the metal shell. This is the scale below. Now here, when you want to do quantitative experiments, you can load the bottom-up one is not very good. You have to go and use metal beam the bottom. Because you want to make these particles separated by exactly a certain amount of distance. If you want to study the distance dependence of the coupling between these two particles, you have to go there. And these are results of electron beam lithography. You can make two disks separated by 2 nanometer. You can make two disks separated by 12 nanometer. You can make two disks separated by 27 nanometer, and so on. And then I go measure the color of this sample with this kind of separation. And you can plot it, and you can there you go, and you can plot it to find that. But one thing that you find is very interesting. What we found is that if you plot the percentage shift of the color versus the distance between them divided by the diameter of the part, the size of the part, you find you get this nice scale for all kinds of sizes. It doesn't make any difference on the sizes. In fact, we found even more. We found that actually, if you do it for silver nanoparticles of different sizes, or for gold nanoparticles of different sizes, you get exactly the same dependence. That means this is a law of nature. That means you can actually write an equation from which, if you know the shift, you can determine the distance between them. Or if you know the distance between them, you can tell what the color is. Very, very useful. In fact, we tested this equation. This is the equation that we got. And so we went to the results of Aristotle's, took different DNAs of different sizes. And he puts gold nanoparticles at the end, at the two ends of the DNA. So and then you see the color when they are that close. We take a longer DNA when the two particles are that far, and so on. And he got this nice table here. This is now, this, he knows what the distances are, but he knows how big the DNA is, and he knows how large the size of the particle is. So he can tell what the size of the distance between the two golden particles is. And so these are his distances that he knows from what he put together. And these are the distances we took his shields. We took the color that he did there. And we went and calculated the distances. And you can see these are very, very close to the ones that he has. So at least, you know, actually, in some of them, I think people believe we can get a number because they don't know if DNA stays the way it is when you put two nanoparticles on it. So any distortion can change distance, and you need to calculate that. Now let's get to cancer now. What happened to the absorbent light? Suppose now the nanoparticle absorbs light. What does it do? That's an interesting problem. The most useful problem to come of, besides the diagnostics and sensors and so on, okay, it rapidly transforms into heat. So that little one nanoparticle that absorbs so much light fast becomes a very hot heater. Many things can be used like a little man put somewhere with a lot of heat in it. You can do a lot of damage. Many things in biology, right? Really do very biology damage here. And and we are going to go through the physics of that. what happens is, if you're heating it a reasonable amount, this hot
amount of heat in the park, it very fast, it heats whatever is around. It will not do it, but it heats whatever is around. That is one way you can you gently heat. Okay. So first it heats the surrounding, by this process, maybe the time of it, time scale of that, all of this is normal. But if you heat it faster, use a nanosecond laser pulse, those atoms now, they won't have time to tell the molecules around it, here we are now. They themselves take the energy and they start moving faster and faster, and they move around, they never know where they came from. That's a liquid. They don't go back to where they used to be. That's solid, that's all it does. But liquid, there is no place for any atom there. They just move around. So you may, you know this experiment, you look around, and this kind of energy, by heating it, it makes a sphere. It melts into sphere. But that's the most stable form of any nanoparticle. And that takes about 10 cubes, actually, you measure that time scale. Now, if you heat it even faster and faster, most atoms don't even have time to melt in the solid or the liquid. They just, the atoms say, my God, it's too hot in here, they just run away, they sublime. So the nanoparticles start at late, becomes smaller and loses this atom from the surface as it goes along. And this ablation, and we made use in all these problems. The first one is the one we spoke about, that's cancer, healing the cancer cells and killing cancer cells. Okay, no nanoparticles in cancer cell diagnostics and phototherapy. Well, I don't have to tell you guys about the grim, results that we have here about cancer, different kinds of cancer. My goodness. For example, the interesting thing is here the breast cancer for females, for women, the age between 40 and 59, there is 1 in 24 get breast cancer. For men, nature was also for men with prostate cancer at that age, 1 in 44. Now, of course, as one gets older, the breast cancer between 60 and 79, for the breast cancer, you get 1 in 13 women get cancer. The prostate for men, it is 1 in 7, it's even worse, get prostate cancer. Now, in terms of the general cancer disease, is it the worst disease to kill people or the heart attacks? Well, they're going back and forth, depends on whose calculation, what year. But it is these two diseases that compete with one another. And in general, from all kinds of cancers, and from all sides, 1 in 3 person between 60 and 79 gets cancer, 1 in 4 person for female. Get cancer, and it is really grim. It is probably I did one thing in my class, written class, for 400 students. Young people, they don't keep an eye on cancer. They're too young; they don't get sick. You know? So I asked them, how many of you have heard or know about a relative or a good friend that died of cancer? 3/4 of the class was. And those are young people, as I said, they're not following family, three. But so it is a bad, disease, and that's why a lot of strong interest in that. Okay, now the people that we did this together are here. Ivan is my son, actually, he's a surgeon, and Shawai is one of the people that work in this area. There's also Prashant, very, very nice number of people here. The number of people in there. Now let's talk about the why all in medicine. It's all that one was very easy to make. Very easy to make. Bottom up, very easy to make. Very high conjugation. You can conjugate it to many things in the body, routine, DNA. And you can conjugate it to the more important antibodies. Very easy. Non-cytotoxic. Really has been shown in general that it is really in fact there's some nano powder but the goal was that many companies in India, they sell it, you know, they for health. In Japan, I'm sure they sell it for health stores. In fact, I'm giving a talk to this one, and one of the right scientists there, he said, how about it catalyzes things and can kill somebody, you know, and probably is right, that is where. But a Japanese professor from Tokyo University got up and he said, in Japan, he spread gold powder over our sushi. It makes us feel good. I said, well, here's your answer from Japan. But they did the statistics. But it is really not there. And in India, you can buy pounds of silver powder and gold powder. Tuna, we already told you. I'm sure you have any tuna color. Very easy. Because where you want it, you can get color anymore. Okay. And then the very important thing, as we see now, enhanced absorption, that makes heat, and or enhanced scattering for bigger particles, that is good for diagnostics. So for both, you just have to pick up the right counts, actually. First thing we did was easy way to do it, and that is, mix maybe colloidal nanoparticle and mix with the some cancer cells, sentence in patients, and some healthy ones. Keep them there for 25 minutes, 30 minutes, and then take them to the microscope, okay, to keep them alive, live cells. And we look at the cells, and you can see here, in all of them, the colloidal nanoparticle just went inside. You see, this is scattered light I'm seeing here. They all inside the cells. Whether it's cancer or healthy ones, they are already in the healthy ones. So it looks like it might be the way by which we go in, it's different, but looking at imaging is not going to use. Both of them look like they take this inside. Well, you know, cytosis and the cell just takes it and it just opens it up. If around it, put it inside to try to get rid of it. So that's not going to be very useful. So the next thing we did, we just had to do antibodies. And as you were talking about this last night, it's the thing of the biologists that did a lot of work for us. And for example, Eckhart is a what happens with these cancer cells, usually have these antigens of proteins that grow over their surface, which the healthy one does not have. So if we have an antibody for this protein and we put gold on it, it will take it and bind it only to the cancer cells, but not to the healthy ones. Okay. So we know the different receptors here that are called different cancer cells. And what you find EGFR is really goes into many, many cancer types. So if we get antibody for EGFR, that is anti-EGFR, we can just find it all in the and take it there. And we just look at the images to look for the scattering from the gold and particles. And that's what we have done here. Here is the percentage binding of different antibodies and so on and so forth. And as you can see, the EMT, the head and neck, that's why I like to work with my son, at 100% binding. Coincidence is extremely high. Okay. Here is what you can see now. Then, so the antibody, the gold and particle, and these are spheres. And we just incubate them with two different kinds of cancer cells and the healthy one. Same type of concentration of everything. And we left them 25 minutes or so. And then we arrange them with these lights under the microscope. Normal microscope. Not a fancy one. And you can see, cancer ones, the gold nanoparticle, most of them are bound to the surface of the organ.
cells are cancer. The non-nucleated cells, and even C cells, you see in every part of the world, placed with the antibody, but you don't see the cells, those are the healthy ones. Now that you see that the cancer cells have so many golden pathway ones, while the healthy ones somewhere here, but the golden pathway are all over the solution here. Now if I put weak light that's absorbed by the golden pathway, a lot of the light will be absorbed here and here, but much less, but the light will be absorbed everywhere. So I will heat the cell directly to this cancer. While if it's not cancer, I have to heat the whole body of everything and then heat it. So at much lower laser light, I can selectively kill the cancer cell without having to affect the healthy one at all. And that's what this slide shows. You can see here the cancer cells here at 19 watts per centimeter squared here. The cancer cells die, the color of dead cell. Whereas the healthy one, I have to go to 57 watts. So when I keep my laser light below 30 watts per centimeter squared, I can finish the cancer cell without having to touch the healthy ones. Now, of course, how about this experiment now? You said that this is visible light in using. What is the breast cancer 5 centimeters inside? I'm going to get to it. The light, visible light, will not get it. So you have to use already the biologist, photobiologist showed us that this region around 8-900 nanometer is has a nice transmission, better than the visible or the further on the visible or the infrared. So if I use light, basal light in this region around 800, and if I use, if I have to use an antibody that absorbs that 800 in heat out of it, I can do it in meter. Of course, I can do it in the sphere, with the skin cancer, or even in the probe, because outside I can do it with the sphere, or I have to penetrate. But if something inside a little bit, I have to use this kind of light and this kind of nanobotany. Well, this is, as you can see here, different size nanorods has different absorption, as we said before. And as you can see, we do the experiment. And fair enough, the cancer cells with the antibody, remember now, using the golden nanorods with the antibody, and you can see, you can see it sits right on the top of the cell, the cancer cell, but it's somewhere here, the healthy ones, the gold nanorods all over. You see the light is red now because the scattered light is red. Not only visible, only engineered infrared. Infrared. Okay, again, I can shine weak lasers on here, I can probably kill those, not as much here, and this is what, oops, okay, well, I'm sure it's also better. I think we'll probably see. But anyway, but we did the experiment, and indeed you can kill those cells at a much lower light intensity in the near infrared. In the near infrared, but this one may have to go higher, much higher in light intensity of the laser. Now, does this work in actual animal? That is the real test of the human, of course. Here we simply disrupt the limited experiments, and you can see here is we created the cancer on both sides, and then after 7 minutes of radiation on this side here, but not here, you find that this stays. Did not change this time, whereas this one kept going, cancer kept going. And here is after exposure for even longer time, cancer is much better behaved than at short time. You can see here this time, the untreated cancer kept growing this time, kept going up in size, while the one that was treated, it just nothing happens to it, just as in the disappointing experimental errors I'm sure. And here it started going down. We couldn't get beyond that point because what happened is we had the two sides with the same mice. The cancer on one side got so big, and the protocol says go beyond that point, you have to sacrifice the mice, so we're going to go beyond that. Now we're doing different protocol and try to see how fast and what happened to the tissues and all these things. So at least the preliminary results sounds good, and hopefully that one day human being can make use of it. So let me just summarize what I have said. First thing, if gold nanoparticles are both excellent light scatterers, useful for diagnostics, and excellent photo heaters, useful in photothermal therapy. The nanospheres are useful for in vitro diagnostics, biopsy, very, very easy, much faster than the regular biopsy now, and in treating surface cancer, skin cancer, throat, and so forth. But not in science. The nanorods are useful for in vivo detection and in vivo treatment if their size is adjusted so that their surface plasma frequency is in the near infrared, where the tissues have the maximum transmission. And the last thing is that preliminary experiments on the mice gave positive results. Now, the people that done work, this is my son, I was in Sarajevo. He's a surgeon at UCSF, mm-hmm. California, San Francisco. And Chauvin is one that did most of the experiments in this field. Frachon is one that does calculation of things, distances, scale, low. And Dr. Wing is the femtosecond laser guy and CW laser guy. And of course, Stefan Link and the one. Hamad, who is now she's in has a big, huge group in Milano in the laser center at the University of Cairo. And Stefan, one of my graduate students, he was in the beginning, and everything he did was positive results. Paper after paper after paper. I kept him. So I was at the position for 2 more years. He published 32 papers. He has more citations. Some of the papers has 600 citations, I think. And he's now a professor at Rice University. And with this, thank you very much.
الابلكيشن اوف نانو بارتكلز المديسنال ابلكيشن الفارماسيوتيكال في برضو بعض الأحاسيس لطلب الدكتوراه والماجستير بكلمة دلوقتي حاليا بس أدار على النانو emulsions and nanogels medicine application. السؤال بقى في هذا المجال what about some medicine application of nanotubes and nanogels in this field or in cancer field?
Then they can
through, goes into the cancer cell much easier than the healthy one, and it goes there, accumulates there, then this time the plant itself is released and starts reacting with the cancer tumors. This is a very, I'm sure they've done animal experiments on that, and there's a company that would sell these conjugated now, it depends where you want it to take it. It's just a matter of what do I add there, when you get there, that will recognize the area where it is diseased. And antibodies now, there's antibody for everything, for protein, DNA, everything. So really, it's playing with biology now and try to conjugate these different material to the responding anti. To get it to where you want to get. And the field itself, I'm sure, I think we are doing right now, even trying to see the binding that they talk about of antibodies. Does it change when I put an antibody on it? Does it get better? Does it get worse? So a lot of physical chemistry, a lot of medical chemistry, there's a lot of it's just the beginning, but it is moving so fast, it's incredible. It's very hard to catch up with what is going on. So I'm sure many people will do anything. But as I said, one has to be careful of toxicity first. That thing we applied for here, we want to test different kinds of nanoparticles. And we try to follow pathology, and we have pathologists to follow different tissues, see how they are affected, where these nanoparticles end up, how do they come out of the body, and all these things. That field is very, very important. Right. There is another question. Aging. Oh, beautiful, I'm sure many people, of course I'm young, I don't have to worry about this. No, but I think you're right. I mean, this is a very important problem. I don't know if they really, I'm not sure if there's much to be done in that area. I have not heard any talks or seen papers. But believe me, I'm sure some people will try to see what the effects are. And they see the actions. Usually nanoparticles are in these things might act as carriers, but might act as catalysts. And the question is, what do you need to do? And most likely what will happen is they're going to try different things and find which one is working and which one is working is what the mechanism is. So the field is open. As I said, it's a completely new material, and there will be work in all these hot areas in biology with this name right now. Yes. Very good question. Thank you.
بداية نرحب بحضرتك بجامعة المنصورة يحيى اللازق أستاذ كلية العلوم. حضرتك اتكلمت عن the use of nanoparticles to detect mutation in the gene or the genetic mutation. Are those a special kind of mutation or all kind of mutation can be detected using this technique? As for example, point mutation or single nucleotide mutation or just a deletion or addition mutation. So I would like from you to elaborate on this.
I must admit I really love in the DNA studies at all. But if I have to guess, that's completely guess. I expect there will be studies test different kinds, change of the genes, for example, and where it's changing, what is happening. I don't know if much. It might be somewhere already. I'm sure somewhere by different techniques. Might not be even by nanoparticles. But I can see, for example, if you try to measure distances between two certain nucleotides, there can be a marker of what is happening to that distance. And then you can have, explanations and probably some even imaging and things like that. But that's completely guess on my part. I have not done much work in that area at all. Yes.
Mohamed Amar, قسم الـ مرحب بيك في جامعة المنصورة في مصر. أنا بس السؤال أيمن وخلمه وجه سؤال كريت. haven't mentioned anything about the role of nanotechnology in ophthalmic practice. Do you think there's any way of using it in the treatment of tumors of the choroid, which is a very serious problem, or you concentrate on the cancer mainly?
We are doing cancer mostly, but I expect different effect in cells. And once you know what the antibody for it, you can destroy it. I mean, this is, just a general methodology here. Find the antibody, find the mark into it, that let it go to that protein or whatever is the receptor from this cell that has this disease, and just heal up my life. That technique is general, actually. But the main thing is, of course, can I get to this cell? Can I get light? Very important thing. It's a photophilter. Can I get light to it? That's very important. Even with cancer, if the cancer is hidden quite a bit, that technique would be useless. So if you can get, say, fiber optics with light to it, and get the antibody first, the good nanoparticle, through the blood to it, then you can get rid of defective cells. That is what my mind, you can get back to it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mona Marai, tissue engineering, Alexandria. Thank you very much, Professor Said, for a present excellent updates on nanotechnology, and I do appreciate the gold nanoparticles as well. From a tissue engineering point of view, the scaffold, how can we characterize the nanoparticles? This is number one. Number two, what is the cell matrix interface strength, and does it difference from a 3D materials or not? Number three, does the sterilization method different since the material become different at the nanoscale? Thank you very much.
Very good, yeah. Very good questions, yes. Characterizing the nanoparticle, I think the best way, especially for gold, for example, is transmission depth microscopy. You can see atoms, and we can see atoms in the nanoparticle, actually. And the shape of it, and everything, very, very easy. And one of the things we like to do in our toxicity tests is what happens to the tissue when the nanoparticle is there. And that means we have to look at the whole region where the tissue is, and look at the nanoparticle shape. Because the nanoparticle itself, I'm sure, will change size, shape, things like that. So we have to follow it by transmission electron microscopy, by different kinds of techniques to check on tissues. That would need a tissue engineer with us like you. It would be wonderful to have. Yeah. The other question I forgot now, does the material change by the nanoparticle? Absolutely. In fact, this is one of the things that it has been used most in right now in applications. They found that, for example, many materials by mixing them with different kinds of nanoparticles, the property, the strength becomes much stronger. Carbon nanotube has been used to. Carbon nanotube is stronger than steel, for example. And by putting it in polymer or polymeric material, I expect tissues can be in the making, for example, things for bones. The nanoparticles, when they make this skin that they use for bones, if they make it from the nanoscale, they show that it is much stronger than the normal one they've been using so far. So definitely the material, and that's where this application material is going to be.
Thank you. My question is, if now we like to establish a lab for nanotechnology on this business, what is the essentials or the prerequisite that we can need to establish from the personnel point of view, their qualifications, the machines required, and how long does it take to be in this field? Thank you.
Well, terms of personnel, I would say a combination of chemists and biologists are very, very important. There are now people who are really in that field that they call nanobiology, which really have enough about the nano, and they come from the biology direction, or people that are artificial people like me. I know the nanotechnology, but I'm trying to read about biology, learn more about biology. But I think a good material chemist in the nano area, there's many nano people now, I mean, would be, you know, some people in that area would be very, very good. Coupling with people in biology department, and some people in chemistry or in the room, would be a very nice mix to get them together in that area. In terms of the equipment, synthetic usually is very useful. Synthetic, because they make things, used to make things. So they, however, the physical, of course, if you talk about properties, you use certain properties. I would say material these days, usually, in fact, it's very interesting. I mean, our department now, I cannot distinguish organic from the bio, from the physics. They all material chemists. And so the field is evolving, actually, mixing everybody together right now. In terms of the equipment called transmission electron microscopy, there's SEM, STM, AFM, all these together. Imaging facility, that's what you mean. How fast? How much money you have? Simple as that. If fast enough, the brains are here. The abilities are already here. And so the faster you have the money and the amount of money, the faster you can have people, couple the people together. And if you have a facility, believe me, you're going to attract people like to come and do work here, where you use the facilities. So I would get a good facilities and for people in the beginning and provide that is free to use facilities, you're going to get a lot of people. And then you can identify those who are the very good ones. And if they're interested to join, very key, that'll be a good way to go.
And how can you help us?
I mean,
how can you help us?
I can send you the names of the companies. I'd be glad to come. No problem. Just ask me and I'll come and
about one fact. You have said that the treatment of cancer cells is very specific. So I'm very concerned about this nanoparticle inside the normal cell in the future. Do you think that it will make these cells potentially malignant later on, or will it leave the cell and clear up the cells all together?
Yeah, there is, what is the toxicity problem? Yeah, absolutely. Here's an interesting thing, for example. Depends what you're trying to cure. I mean, if it's a cancer problems, all the chemicals used in chemotherapy have toxic effects. They vary. So the question measured is how useful is it compared to the disease itself? Which one kills first? Is the disease or the nanoparticle? That's a simple question. Especially this trial experiment when you have the final stages of cancer. I tell you, I have a very close relative of my wife went through this, and it really is bad, and I want anything just try, you know. So I think there will be some toxicity, and they will measure what level it is, and under what condition it should be, it would be used. So if you were told that, I think it'll be fine. But you're quite right, we have to do it. Happy birthday, right? Yeah.
I want to ask also again about the toxicity. I'm very concerned about that, whether nanoparticles are used in diagnosis apart from cancer. We are not dealing now with cancer. We are dealing with diagnostics. We are dealing with the drug delivery system. You have explained clearly that substance, when it is changing its nanoscale, it changes its properties. So we can never judge that gold will be non-cytotoxic. Of course, the Japanese who had the gold spread on their sushi never use it in nanoscale. So how can we judge? How can we know that nanoparticles are not cytotoxic?
Very
good
question. Well, this is our actually support plan to get test toxicity is from EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, not from NIH, not from anything. And the reason is, I mean, this nanoparticle is what we use in bacteria, in electronics, in this. People will be making them, people will be selling them. So we need to know, can we put grades on the toxicity of it, like any chemical we have, like potassium cyanide, like kill a person, you see. So we have, as you said, as new chemicals, we have to put there in the book of our safety what is labeled on it. So each type of nanoparticle will have, is it class 1, is it class 2, is it class 3, and according to this class, it will be used only in certain things. And so what you're saying is, we really should, very soon, before it spreads and used in everything, it should be classified and know the safety using of it. Should I wear gloves? Should I wear a mask? All these things has to be developed and put them together, right? Well, that's a very important point.
Okay, I have another question. In treating cancer, why not trying ablation? Why only heating? Why not trying ablation?
Trying ablation?
Ablation, yes.
Oh, but then you would have very strong laser fire. And then that will kill the healthy as well.
And my last question, are there any trials to get rid of hepatitis C virus using nanotechnology? Hepatitis C virus from the cell, to get rid of hepatitis C virus when it infects the liver cells.
Absolutely, again, it's an antibody problem. Whatever virus you have, we have an antibody somewhere. And then you just find the gold nanoparticle to it. There is some chemistry that has to be done. And then again inject, and this will get to the virus and so on. So I'm sure some people are not working on this. Yeah, yeah, that's a very important problem. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah,
sure.
Hassan Adnan, Professor of Organic Chemistry, Faculty of Science. I would like to express my thanks for your nice presentation, nice lecture. Your lecture included two parts, one of them in the chemistry, firstly, and the second in medicine. I'll ask as a view of chemistry, please. You said that the precipitation of semiconductors for nanoparticles by mixing solid cadmium salts or cadmium oxides with selenium compounds. Firstly, I would like to ask about the kind of solvents used for the solubility of this cadmium. The second question we have, there are a lot of selenium compounds used for these reactions. I think this is specific selenium compounds.
Actually, way the cadmium cyanide is made is really it uses some kind of cadmium compound, sometimes cadmium oxide. They used to use dimethyl cadmium, and they found this is very dangerous. So now they use cadmium, another paper came that everybody now is using cadmium oxide instead. And then using selenium powder, and they put it in the right combination and they inject it in a very hot solution of solvent and cadmium material at 230 degrees centigrade, and they inject it at the right temperature. And the temperature at which they inject it will determine the size of the nanoparticle they make. So this is a very famous example. It's very highly cited paper. It started with the Gawande group at MIT. So in this case, and you get it in an organic solvent actually. And then once you get it in a can in an organic solvent, then you can exchange the cadmium material to more polar solvent and you put it more. So it is really terrible. As you said, the selenium is a very bad one. We can do cadmium sulfide much easier. I can put sodium sulfide, which is soluble in water, and I can put cadmium nitrate, which is soluble in water, and then cadmium and the sulfide, they get together and they try to precipitate. But the selenium is very bad, as you said, yes.
Mohamed Farid Ustaz, I am really impressed with your presentation as well as your presentation at the TV a couple of days ago. I have a comment and an question. My comment, you are already started to talk about the aging process. We know that in many thoughts about the longevity, this is a problem now. Over the world, started here in the developmental countries. In the developing countries, there is how to make it useful longevity. In Madrid 2002, the second of seven countries, I don't remember, of population was there. They started to do some ideas to transmit some ideas about the tissue engineering, the artificial intelligence, and suspended animation also. Because we know that the 2050, maybe the ratio, the age ratio will be reversed, and above 80 or above 100 may exceed more than the young. We know that also affects that over 120 years there is no. The human body cannot work well. So here, my inquiry about how you already talk about some catalysts to stop the cell aging or so. About the nanotechnology here, I'm adding more about some. To build some cells, transmit some cells, to educate itself to do some job or not?
Yeah, well, as I said, a lot of work needs to be done, of course. I mean, medicine is like chemistry, it's an experimental science. I mean, you have to do experiments and see what the results are. And either things can catalyze something or can inhibit something or that's causing. So if you know the exact cause, it becomes a little bit easier, especially more we know about more properties of these nanoparticles. So as time goes on, I hope that we make many, many different kinds of nanoparticles and with many, many, many different properties, either in the direction of catalysis or direction of photothermal properties or just chemical properties or just thermal properties. See, nanoparticles are so small, you can get them to react themselves to something, you see. In fact, we did that, doing quite a good work in catalysis with transition beta nanoparticles. And we finding out that they just don't act as a catalyst. They actually act as a chemical reactant itself. So the more we know about these dysfunctions and infection, we the first people just about a month ago to show people that the comparison with platinum is actually making a complex, and that complex is one that goes in solution and does the catalysis, not the nanoparticle itself. So the nanoparticle is supplying a chemical to doctor or something. So we just have to know these different properties, and hopefully there'll be some people take this property to the point where once the mechanism of aging is known, to try to intercept somewhere in a cell or something like that, yes. Very good question, thank you.
عادل المنصوري رئيس الطب الشرعي والسموم كل الطب المنصوري. انا عاوز اسال الرول تكنولوجي ان جرين كيمستري بيكوز اتس فيري فيري بروبلم انترناشونال الانفايرمنتال
سيستم فور ميني ييرز. هاو دي نانو تكنولوجي كان ديستراكت اور سيستم انكلوز بيبل انكلوز لايك هايدرو كاربون والثيوكسين.
Then the nanotechnology can destruct this resistant organic pollutant in the environment.
Yeah, well, again, that's what I was saying. We have to know the catalytic properties of these, especially transition metal nanocarriers. There was a meeting directly that I just came from about 3 weeks ago. It is a huge field, and a whole new catalytic properties we don't know anything about yet will be discovered. And of course, as you said, to get green chemistry, if you can carry out a lot of the reactions in a safe way and faster using nanoparticles as a catalyst, you're getting to all getting closer and closer to greener chemistry. But it's all really just collecting results of properties, different catalysis and reactions and so on. And the field right now is just making different nanoparticles. And then some of it start studying the properties, like we took the gold or the catalysis of some traditional metals. And some other people are doing other kinds of properties, you see. And one day, going, there will be a lot of properties, a lot of nanoparticles. Then people who are interested in a specific problem have to go there and see which result they have to pick up from, and they apply to my particular problem. And that's still to
work. Thank you very much for the interesting lecture, and I'm really interested in using this nanoparticles for diagnostics, especially in three-dimensional confocalism microscopy. As well, really in our department, and because I run in the school of clinicalism, and I have Dr. Mona Bak, she's expert in this confocal, and also Mona Bak, the Institute of Laser, and she gave the opportunity to us to have this laser unit to work in this microscope. And so, can you borrow us some probes just to try for detection of some common malignancy like lymphoma cells, whatever, bladder cancer cells, breast cancer, to try this detection of three-dimensional, because these drops are big, it's not really on the market.
Studies and so on. applied as a biologist or a material scientist, or just depends on what the problem requires. ولكن الحقيقه يعني طبعا مشكور على حاجات كثيره. الحقيقه يوم الاثنين اللي فات كنت في اسكندريه بضغط حاجه في جامعه مكتبه اسكندريه بضغط برضه، وبعد كده في يوم الاربعاء في المركز القومي، ويوم الخميس في كل النهارده حضرتك يعني خصصنا الجزء الاكبر يعني. طبعا نشكر حضرتك وبشكر بالنسبة للعينات اللي حضرتك بعتها لنا والكنائس اللي احنا بعتنا. طبعا يعني بالنسبة لجامعة المنصورة حضرتك يعني متوصى بينا ونشكر حضرتك جدا يعني. دلوقتي
السؤال كان ايه؟
نعم
السؤال يعني نخش على البحث.
طبعا هو في الشروط الثاني لان هو الدكتور هيجي يناقش رسالة في اول يناير في كلية العلوم جامعة المنصورة حسب وعده ربنا يديله الصحة ويقدر يجي. دلوقتي بالنسبة للسؤال هذا كل مرة كنت يعني بتعلمنا حاجات كتيرة وبتقابل خالص بتقول خدوا جربوا الحاجات دي. النهاردة حضرتك طالع على الطيارة بعد المحاضرة وما خدتش حاجة الجدية بتاعت كل مرة. فيعني يا ريت حضرتك برضه بعض العينات دي خاصة جامعة المنصورة
يعني عاوزين الهدية يعني؟
ايوه يا دكتور انت يعني عاوزين الحاجة بتاع كل مرة يعني
كده.
نعم خلاص اعتبرها هي دي بس في جامعة المنصورة مش هي
عندنا هدية يا باشا.
شكرا.
حد نسأل أسئلة؟ أسئلة فلور إز أوبن لغاية الساعة 2. واحد عاوز يفسد حاجة أوي يعني إن شاء الله في كذا وفي كذا يسأل. اتفضل لا سأل الدكتور الدكتور بيه بيه الأول الدكتور أيوه قدام كوريو يا
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. This is Dr. Ahmed Demir, Professor from Kulu. Really, I have a comment and a question. The comment is that using hyperthermia or destroying the malignant cell by heating came to a deadlock because it was used several times and in many randomized clinical trials, and there is no significance between it and other methods of cancer treatment. So the main point is the drug delivery system, and this came to my question. What about the mechanism of delivery system? Just by dermal growth factor or something like that? And if there is a difference between the normal cell and the malignant cell, because when I use the delivery system, it may increase the delivery to the normal cell and the malignant cell. So what is the mechanism of the delivery system? Thank you.
Well, this animal experiment we are doing now, we are using two ways of delivery of this nanoparticle. One of them is the antibody, as I showed, and we inject directly the solution into the tumor body. The other one we are using also, and we have used and we have been very dissolved, is just as I said, you put the nanoparticle in a pig, and you inject this in the blood, and there is a difference in the cancer cell and the healthy cell in getting these nanoparticles into the cell. The cancer cell, the vascular are much more open, and you can get this in. The healthy one does not get in. And so you make use of that, and you accumulate the nanoparticle in there, and you get the laser added in, and you get the treatment that way. But you quite like that, that's a big difference there, right? Right. Thank you.
حمدي حسني كلينيكال ادمنستريتور من المنصوره يونيفرستي فاكولتي اوف دنتستري كونسيرن ويز مالي. في ان اور فيلد وي يوز ريستوراتيف ماتيريال وي ان اور فيلد وي يوز ريستوراتيف ماتيريال بيست ان نانو تكنولوجي. ذيس ماتيريال كان وي يوز نانو بلاسترز اند نانو باركيز. What's the difference between nanoplaster and nanoparticles?
You know, there's a lot of studies in the gas phase being done. I actually was involved in this almost 20 years ago, and in which you make atoms, they can cluster together up to from 3, 4, 5, 6, 25, 30, 50. Now, these are the clusters. Then the field of the bottom-up came in picture in solution, and they start making a much larger sum. Thousands of atoms in gold there, you see. And so usually nanoparticles are larger in size. And nanoplaster usually for those people that are gas phase reactions, catalysis with nanoplaster, something like that, and they can calculate things, and beautiful work has been done in the last 20 years. But slowly the nanoparticle, because of its usefulness in many other applications, and do it in solution, you can look at it and see how it looks. In clusters, you can only measure the mass, you can use a mass spectrometer. So the field of cluster properties gave way to the nanoparticle in that field. Yeah. So just a matter of their size and are they in solution or gas phase and so on.
Are there any signs of getting rid of stones, whatever the place in the body, in the main fat, in the bladder, using the nanotechnology, getting rid of stones?
Getting rid of what?
Stones. As what? Stones. What's the role of nanotechnology in?
There will be smart people somewhere, and they will be able to make use of it. I mean, if you can degrade, and well, right now, I guess we can use laser, sharp, huge, pulse of laser. Now, in the future, somebody can get some gold nanoparticles around the stone, and then use a much weaker laser pipe, you could probably do the same thing. In other words, what we have done with this phototherapy, therapy, with the gold is that you can the laser, the microsecond laser, they go there with a fantastic amount of energy and they kill everything. The cancer, non-cancer, tissues, everything, they just wipe out everything there. And that's just like the old ancient way of doing things. Now, this is what we call the SCL phototherapy. We call it, the other one is P phototherapy, PTT. Yeah, PTT. Now we have a paper already in review of lasers and medicine and a few other review articles we have invited to write. We call it, our technique is PPTT, plasmonic phototherapy therapy, using the strong absorption of the plasma resonance absorption to really put the energy in, and you don't need as much energy from the laser, but everything you put in will get taken by the bone. It's a much more gentler way of doing it. But one day, somebody will find a way of getting to that stone, I'm sure it might not be already in there. He's doing that?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just asking. Can I ask the final question? Okay. Thank you very much. My name is Said Abdullah. I'm from the Bank of Hope Sangai in Mansoura University. May I remind that 30 years ago, photodynamic therapy, when a photosynthesizer is injected and then activated by a light, mostly laser, came out with green homes, and I spent 5 years working in this field. Now this chemical stands still because of the fact that you cannot deliver it into deep-seated organs. As you said, I think now you are in the phase of nanotechnology that went in some 10 years ago with photodynamic therapy. I hope that you don't come to a standstill because the rate limiting step is how to deliver an effective dose of the photosynthesizer photodynamic therapy or of a nanoparticle in the nanotherapy would be a, rather than photodynamic therapy, would be a real phototherapy. So I think you said before, but things working very nicely in the lab, we have demonstrated.
demonstrated that it can kill all types of cancer in the lab, but in the body, especially deep cell tumor, it doesn't work. So I need just elaboration in how we're going to pass this obstacle. Thank you very much.
Maybe you want to talk about how you get the light there. Yeah, that is, but that wasn't any kind of light therapy. But you know, with fiber optics, you can get this anywhere. You can get it in this pond, you can get it in anything, but there will be certain things that just will be hard to get to. And they have to do X-ray and take a chance of killing other things around it. If this is the only way, well, there's going to be another to use. It could be combination of both of them. Try first one. If it doesn't work, you have to use X-ray, which goes through everything. So it depends on exactly where the cancer is, really. And the white light is not, as I said in my talk, you have to be able to get the light there, because that's part of the drug you're using. Many places you can get the light of the breast cancer, for example. You can get the light 12, 15 centimeters. So from either side, you can get two. That would be fine, you see. And in this case, you can even just focus the light, the laser light. So you can send the beam, so it just gets focused, it goes in a cone, and then you just focus at this 10 centimeter beam, so focus is 10 centimeter away from the surface. So by using just light itself, the beam itself, you don't even have to use fibers or anything like that. If it's skin cancer, you just shine light straight, you know. Again, it depends on where the biggest thing is breast cancer, really. And I think that you can definitely get to it. By just even direct light, you don't even have to use other things. Yeah, yeah. Very good question. Thank you.
That's not very good. مع حتى باي تكنولوجي في يا اما في كليه الطب او يبقى حاجه مركزيه عشان فعلا يعني نقدر نعمل ونشتغل ويبقى في كل الاجهزه ويقدر يطلع يبقى حاجه اوبجيكتيف او برودكتيف يعني ليها انتاجيه يعني وممكن تسوق و الكلام ده كله انما طول ما احنا بهذا الشكل وما فيش مثلا حاجه مركزيه ما فيش حد هيقدر يعمل اي حاجه نهائيا فانا بقترح على الاستاذ الدكتور احمد بيومي ويبقى دي فكره من دلوقتي ان هو فعلا معهد بايوتكنولوجي ومعهد نانو تكنولوجي وفعلا ويجهز احدث الاجهزه والامكانيات وانا متاكد انها هتبقى النتيجه كويسه باذن الله وانا طلبت هذا الطلب من الدكتور مجدي ابو ريان قبل كده لكن طبعا لم ينفذ هذا الايه المشروع. شكرا.
الكليات السابقة ومدى يعرفوني بترشيحات
يسمى بصندوق البحوث والتنمية التكنولوجية عشان الناس يبقوا يحكموا المشروعات اللي هتتم تقديمها ويتابعوا ويشوفوا سير المشاريع والكلام ده كله. الاستجابة مش عايز اقول ضعيفة بل منعدمة باستثناء المشروع اللي تقدم فيه الاستاذ دكتور محمد رمضان شروح، وقعدنا شهر ونص نخاطب كتابة وشفاهة ورجاء في اجتماعات مدرسية النورس، لدرجة ان انا بيت خجلان ان انا ببعت نائب جامعة المنصورة هذا المشروع الوحيد، مشروع عظيم جدا متكامل، واعتقد ان يعني الفيدباك انا كنت كتبته شديد تقييم هذه المشروعات، لكن علمت كده ان في اللي في سعادة وفي تقييم وتقدير للمشروع الكل. فبس احنا يعني ايه الريسورس بتاعنا يكون سريع لكن هو اوريدي كان.
اتفضل يا سعادة الدكتور. انا عندنا الساعة 2 فلسه العرض سبحان الله
ممكن لو تسمحوا بس شغل الريسورس الاف بي 7 الاف بي 7 اللي هو ده اللي هو يعني المفروض احنا فيه دلوقتي في بند كبير بالنسبه لهذا الموضوع وبالنسبه للتمويل موجود، بس مين ان احنا نتقدم ولا نتكلم الدكتور وليه يتفضل مشكورا هتبقى فرصه كبيره جدا كلنا هنستفاد، لكن الاف بي 7 طبعا الاف بي 6 انتهت الاف بي 7 احنا فيها وقدرنا غايه الامر لو كان في بيصرفوا مليارات من اليورو ومستعدين ومعدومين وهم بديل، والدكتور مصطفى لو يعني تفضل مشكورا ويعني يمد ايده معانا بالنسبه للدكتور وليم انا متاكد ان هتبقى فيها ريسبونس كبير جدا، لان المشكله مشكله تمويل وهم مش هيدونا تمويل، هيدونا اجهزه، ما احنا مش عارفين اكتر من اجهزه. لا يعني كل موجود، لكن الناس اللي هتبقى موجود والناس اللي هتكون موجوده كل حاجه جاهزه، بس احنا نتقدم نبقى جاهزين والدكتور مصطفى وطبعا يعني ولو الدكتور طبعا يعني الدكتور وليم يعني هيبقى يعني
بس عشان الموضوع الاف تي 7 ولا حاجه الموضوع تطوله مجموعه اوروبيه فالدكتور يعني يا مصطفى اسفه مش ديسيجن ميك فلوس المؤسسه الاوروبيه في روسيا فحضرتك اللي بين ايده يدك في الغريب ما تلبسنيش انا الوقت اللي
عندك بس لازم يبقى لينا قائد يا دكتور لازم يبقى لينا قائد عندك
حضرتك سامحني حضرتك رئيس مجلس مال اورجانيك من اورجانيك وات ايفر يو سي ذا بارتنرز يوروبيان بارتنرز يو رايت ا كونجوينت بروجكت بارت اوف بي امبلمنتد هير بارت اوف بي امبلمنتد ذير اند يو ار بارت والعمليه ادي تقريبا بشكل عام عاوز موجود وعلى كتابه بس عاوز موجود وعلى مواصلات وكذا 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 ولازم يبقى
واحنا كلنا تحت امر
بس
واحنا كلنا تحت امر
لا تحت امر
لا لازم يبقى لينا قائد يا دكتور لازم يبقى لينا قائد
لا يا رئيس الجامعه لشغل البحث
ده مشغل جدا
يا دكتور ده مرفوض يعني دعنا لا نتحرز الفئات دي انا بقالي 3 سنين وانا نادي دراسات عليا عمال برضه رجاء حرم ان يكون للجامعه استراتيجيه البحث العلمي على بعض الملف معلش لا الله يخليك الله يخليك معلش فخلاص يعني انا عايز اقول ايه حتى دوبليكيشن مش مطلوب لان حتى ال 19 ان احنا يعني فايبريليتنج يونيفرسيتي خلاص في مشروع اهو فقدمنا ليه مفيش مشكله في الكلام الدوله قالت مفيش مشكله في الكلام وعلينا ان احنا يعني مفيش مشكله في التمويل بس يكون في مشروع جد واعتقد ان لما قدم مشروع جد يبقى بقى ان لما في النهايه يبقى المشروع كده جاي موجود واصبح في توجه بقى وعنف شديد جدا صدقني حضرتك للتفرغ وللعمل الجاد وان هيكون في مقابل هذا كومبنسيشنز او يعني انسنتيفز بلاش انسنتيفز جيده جدا 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 وانا اعتقد ان في كليه العلوم مفيش مشكله فبس يعني ايه احنا يعني معنى ايه احنا اتكلمنا كتير خلاص المشروع اللي تقدمنا وربنا يكرمنا ويقع علينا الاختيار شأن حاجتين مهمين جدا 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 ان جامعه المنصوره تقدمت بمشروعين لما يسمى بكليات التميز نعمل من ربنا سبحانه وتعالى ان احنا
كليات الجامعه بس هيبقى فيري ستريكت فيري كونديشن ولازم يكون موفق. فاهو احنا كنا عاملين قعدنا سنين عمر طويل نقول وصول الامكانيات وصول الامكانيات وصول الامكانيات وحقيقه ما جاش في وصول الامكانيات لان في مثل المراكز الطبيه لما طلعت الجهاز الهضمي ومركز الكلى وخلافه ده يدل ان قصه وجود امكانيات قصد ما ده مش موجود بس احنا عايزين جديه وعايزين وقت وعايزين بتاع ودعونا بقى ايه احنا اتكلمنا كتير نخلينا نشتغل.
اتفضل
يا بيه
اتفضل.
هو بس لو سمحت يا دكتور مصطفى this is a personal matter. I'm preparing a grant to be funded by USAID and it is in the breast cancer delivery system nanoparticles related to cathepsin L and when I am preparing the proposal they wanted me to have an American partner to be present in me to have the fund. But I will be very happy if you help me and you will be the American partner in this situation to have the fund.
Absolutely,
it will be fine. Okay. I will send you the proposal and through the email and we'll make this all your communication and then I submit the proposal and we hope that we can get the fund.
Absolutely.
I have 3-4 of these types joined. Okay. We can have one here in Mansoura with Faculty of Medicine.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's free.
Okay. Thank you. Shukran.
نشكره شكرا جزيلا نتمنى ان نراك دائما فيما بيننا وعبر الانترنت وهو راجل يعني وقت شوفه totally open for collaboration and conjoint projects etc. هو بروفايد ذات ذي ميك سنس مش كده بس